Thank you, sir. May I now request the Chief Justice of India, Mr. Justice Sharad Bobde, to please address the August Assembly.
Good morning to you all. Shri Narendra Modi, the Honorable Prime Minister of India. Shri Ravi Shankar Prasad, the Honorable Union Minister for Law and Justice. My esteemed colleague, Justice Ramana, Justice Arun Mishra, Justice Nageshwar Rao, the Attorney General for India, Shri Venugopal, my distinguished brother and sister judges of the Supreme Court of India, Honorable Chief Justices and judges of the many countries, Chief Justices and judges of the High Courts, the Solicitor General, the Chairman Bar Council, the SCBA President, the SCORA President, senior advocates, and there is a large section of academics, all of them, the directors of the academies, the vice chancellors, members of the press, the Secretary General, ladies and gentlemen. It is my proud privilege to welcome you all to the first ever international conference hosted by India under the aegis of the Supreme Court of India. I extend my gratitude to the Prime Minister Narendra Modi for having accepted our invitation to grace this event. I am delighted with the response that my brethren in robes have shown in attending this international dialogue about the judiciary and the changing world. Justice Bhandari from the International Court of Justice also found the time to be with us today. The zeitgeist of our times has been incredible technological development. The entire world today is interconnected like the World Wide Web itself, and a small change in one corner of the world can result in changes in different parts of the world. Judiciaries all over the world are dealing with this kind of change. What might be called a rights revolution, a technological revolution, and a demographic revolution. Our decisions no longer impact only those who live within our jurisdictions, but also those who live in other jurisdictions, some very far away. A conference like this offers opportunities for dialogues between judges from various jurisdictions in the world to exchange ideas and gain knowledge from each other on many aspects of gender justice, right to privacy, populism, environment, and sustainable development. I won't go into the details of the subjects. That India is a melting pot of myriad cultures and traditions is well known. This is equally true of its judicial system and institutions. We have assimilated legal cultures of all civilizations who have come to our shores. The Mughals, the Portuguese, the French, the Dutch, and finally the English. Right from conventional court systems to customary methods of adjudication, our rules of evidence are not only the conventional rules based on the Anglo-Saxon Evidence Act. There is a diverse mixture of traditions of the past infused with the present, looking toward the changing time. In the northeast of this country, it might be interesting for members from foreign jurisdictions to know, there is a chicken liver test which is employed to determine the guilt in the absence of direct evidence. The priest selects a small chick, cuts his neck, removes its liver, examines it, and hands it over to the other members of the court, the panchayat, for examination. The panel then decides collectively on whether the accused is guilty, post the examination of the liver. There is also the practice of taking oath by holding the tooth of a tiger. I think the implied condition is that if he lies, a tiger will kill him. This is the fascinating diversity, and there's a book by the Supreme Court which deals with this diversity. Before these cultures reached our shores, India had a well-established system of courts. The rules were all contained in scriptures which prescribed an open hearing in courts. I'm talking of ancient times. In the presence of officers of the court. For example, the Vyas Smriti provides the various stages for a valid decision. They are these: the plaint, the written statement, issues, evidence, its analysis, arguments of the lawyers, provisions of law, and finally, that the decision should be of the members of the bench. The last requirement is that the judgment should have a royal seal. It seems nothing has changed too much over the years. Interestingly, there is in the Smriti a definition of what definition should be. It says, the definition should be precise, unequivocal, having universal meaning, universally capable of understanding. It should not be plagiarized and not prohibited from being stated openly. I recall these ancient traditions only to emphasize that a well-structured judicial system is about 2,000 years old in this country or more, and has always been at the bedrock of India's legal history. Our constitution is magnificent, not just for its detail, but also for the international inspiration that it drew and continues to draw. The constitution makers embraced a famous saying from the Rigveda, which is Ano Bhadraha Krutavo Yantu Vishvataha, which means let noble thoughts come to us from all universe. The founding fathers of this post-colonial country studied various models of the constitution from all directions. There were former dominions of the British Empire, such as Ireland and Australia, where the British system of governance was adopted in the form of a constitution. There was Japan, where after the World War, a constitution was given to them by the victors. There was the United States of America, where individual rights formed the very basis of their constitution. There were many constitutions of France, most of which embodied the principle of justice, liberty, and equality. The Constitution of India therefore synthesized what is probably the perfect blend of all that came before it and tailored it to fit this country's diversity and thought. At the heart of the Constitution was the individual, and the rights of individual were recognized as fundamental. These rights have been beautifully balanced with demands of public order, morality, and health. Amongst the dominant thoughts when the Constitution was being drafted was a thought by the great Swami Vivekananda, who said, I thought it was a very modern thought, liberty of thought and action is the only condition of life, of growth and well-being. Where it does not exist, the man, the race, the nation, or institution which bars the power of free thought and action of an individual, even so long as that power does not injure others, it is devilish and must go down. A feature often neglected in our Constitution is a chapter of fundamental duties, which was not there originally. Imposing on every citizen the duties to abide by the Constitution, the whole of it, and respect its ideals and institution. You know, Mahatma Gandhi, once said, the exercise of rights depends on one's sense of duty. This follows from what he had written in Hindi Swaraj, where he argued that real rights are a result of performance of duty. Modern jurists might think that Gandhiji was obsessed with duties, but he thought that duties were all important. And there is a part where he said, a part of his talk where he says that if everybody performs his duty, all rights are taken care of. This is how he dealt with the duties of citizens. The Constitution also created a strong and independent judiciary, which was separated from the executive and the legislature. We have strived at every turn, not just as an institution, but also as a citizenry, to keep these basic ideals intact. Probably the most fundamental feature of most constitutions is the idea of the rule of law. And that is certainly the motto of the Indian Supreme Court, which says, where there is adherence to law, there is victory. Yato dharmas tato jayaha. After we gave the Constitution to ourselves, it fell upon this judiciary to interpret it. The judiciary, right from 1950, looked for inspiration from across the globe to find creative solutions to constitutional problems. It is interesting that in the first important case on fundamental rights, A.K. Gopalan's case, the Supreme Court quoted law from the American, Japanese, Irish, Canadian, and English courts. Ever since, we have not shied away from looking for inspiration. Conferences such as these, in a sense, celebrate this universality and seek a better expression through the challenges that the judiciaries of the world face. Undoubtedly, the success of the rule of law in our country depends on how the judiciaries respond to such challenges and how they emerge from these challenges. I do hope that at the end of the conference, all of us would be benefited by learning from each other and have a clearer definition of the roles of the judiciary in the changing world. In this spirit, I warmly welcome you all to this conference. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Thank you very much, sir. May I now request our chief guest, the Honourable Prime Minister of India, Mr. Narendra Modi ji.